With us. Those of you in live stream, we welcome you in the name of the Lord also. Tonight will be, this will be our 28th exposition of the Gospel of John. We're going to be commence the third chapter tonight. Now, I had a word of interpretation and encouragement I'd like to deliver before I begin about what I think is happening and the various trials and difficulties that have surfaced. God is teaching our fingers to fight. He teaches us how to respond in these times that are not at all pleasant. Teaching us to fight. For some, he's teaching us how to be abased. Teaches us how to get along with hardly anything. This is, God does this.
Amen.
For some, it may be chastening, which for the time doesn't seem to be pleasant. It's grievous. But he is readying us for something.
Yes.
You remember the church at Philadelphia in the Revelation was one of the premier churches. They just about had been worn out. They had just a little strength left. They'd been fighting. He said, but I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to keep you from the hour of temptation that's coming on all the earth.
Yeah.
How about that? How about that?
Yeah.
I think God still does things like this. And if he can keep you from the hour of temptation that's coming on all the earth, that's like a global... That's worth handling a few foot soldiers.
Amen.
Some of these skirmishes that are irritating, that tend to sap our strength.
Yeah.
It's worth it to learn how to handle them if you can be delivered from a greater thing yet.
Amen.
It's just, you can stand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If you're in trial, you can. Yes. God can make you stand.
Amen.
See, you can do it. One more word. I speak as someone who's been through trials. And am going through some. Don't look at tomorrow and think, bring your trials to the next day. All God expects you to do is handle what you got today. That's it. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. That's how the scripture says it.
Yes.
And so Satan will try and tempt you to worry about, what about tomorrow? How's this all going to turn out? Well, the truth of the matter is, we don't know how it's going to turn out.
Yeah.
But see, God's the one that's turning it out.
Mm-hmm.
So I encourage you to be strong in faith, boast one another's faith. Your objective is to just get through the day. Get through the day. If you can make it safe to bed tonight, confess your sin, go to sleep clean, and ask the Lord to give you some songs in the night.
Yeah. Amen.
Ask him. He can do this.
Yes.
He can give you. Sometimes the only relief you get is when you're unconscious. But he can give you songs in the night. So I wanted to, that cheers me, so I figured it might cheer your heart too. We're beginning John the third chapter tonight. Now there's something about the real Jesus that attracts humble and contrite hearts. If you can ever get Jesus into the situation, humble and contrite hearts, they're drawn to him. And it's not just curiosity or interesting or novel or something like that. It's not that people just like some new thing, you know. It's not that. When Jesus is around, there's a drawing power that accompanies him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He said, if I be lifted up, he's talking about his crucifixion.
Yeah.
If I be lifted up, will draw. See, but he's got to be around to do the drawing.
Yeah.
People had to be conscious of them for it to be the drawing. So this drawing it can't be discerned by flesh of the natural man. They can't tell us. See, the most effective approach to reaching people for Christ, and this is something you can't can this,
yeah, that's right.
and distribute it and sell it, is to make Jesus as clear and plain as you can. Then he does the drawing. See, that's the secret to effective, what they call soul winning. That's the secret to it. And we're seeing about this in John, is to the degree that men who represent themselves as being from God, ministers and teachers, to the degree that their subject matter is things of this world, they have hidden Christ.
Amen.
Christ cannot be seen through these men. I'll be dogmatic about that too. You can't begin with human trouble and lead people to Christ. it's not that that shouldn't be done. It can't be done. But see, people are trying this. They're trying this all the time. They start out with some kind of an earthly debility or handicap and try and lead people to Christ from that. That's not how to do it. You ought to know that from John the Baptist. You've got to start with God's assessment of humanity and their absolute need of remission of sin. You've got to start there. And that'll lead to Jesus. So these interests that have been quite popularized in recent years, recent decades, about focusing on personal, domestic, and national challenges, and then try and take people from that to Jesus, this won't work, because Jesus didn't come to bring peace on earth. I mean, he said this. We know this. This is not something we speculate about. He said, don't even think I come to bring peace on earth. I didn't come to settle earthly problems. So you can't lead them. See, it makes perfect sense, doesn't it? Everybody can see this, can't you? If that's not why I come, then you can't start with those troubles and end up with people being at the feet of Jesus. It just won't work. That's all. You've got to approach people in the context of God. You can't invent your own context and serve God. So when Jesus spoke and worked, he did so within the context that God had established, and he refused to be turned aside. He told people, look, when I talk, it's what the Father told me to say. When I work, it's what the Father told me to do. So he made it clear what he was doing.
Yeah, right.
He wasn't asking, what's your trouble here? He knew all things already. You don't have to tell. Jesus knows what troubles you got. It goes without saying that only those who see Jesus as the Father who's represented him can benefit from him. Any other Jesus is another Jesus.
Amen.
It's not the real one. All right, let's look at this text. John 3, we're going to look over the first three verses. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. The same came to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi, we know that thou art a teacher come from God, for no man can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Some answer him. There was a man of the Pharisees. The Living Bible says of the sect of the Pharisees. The Amplified Bible says, and a certain man among. Now, here was a man who was part of a group concerning which Jesus never said one good word. Now, he's a part of that group. Never said one good word about the Pharisees. In fact, he said, except if your righteousness doesn't exceed that of the Pharisees, you can't get into the kingdom of God. So the Pharisees were the most disciplined. They were the what we call ascetics. They deprived themselves harsh discipline. Outwardly, they look good. Even Jesus said, they're a good man, they look good, beautiful house. But inside, full of dead men's bones. See, though they, so far as ordering their life external, they didn't need any help group. Sorry about that, but that's just the way it is, isn't it? They didn't need anybody to tell them how to live outwardly. Their outward lives were impeccable. But Jesus said, you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. They were standing in the door. With all their punctilious discipline, they were stopping people from coming to God. What he told them. Nobody knew this about Pharisees. There's no word about anyone suspecting the Pharisees were this kind of people. He said they didn't enter in themselves. Those that were entering in, they stopped them. He said, you devour widows' houses. And for pretense, you make long prayers to kind of impress people. Nobody knew this, not until Jesus come along. He said, now you compass land and sea to make one proselyte. These were soul winners of first rank. Compass land and sea to make one. He said, when you made him, you make him twofold, a child of hell and yourself. Well, that's strong stuff now, brethren. Jesus would be kicked out of a church today if he said that.
Oh, yeah.
Now, maybe that's what's happened. I don't know. He said to them, he said, you're fools and you're blind. These are the Pharisees. This is a group that Nicodemus belonged to. He said, you've omitted the weightier matters of the law. Blind guys are strained at a gnat and swallow a camel. You're full of extortion and excess, he said. You're full of hypocrisy and iniquity. He says, you're the children of those that kill the prophets. He said to them, you serpents, you generation of vipers, how can you escape the damnation of hell? This is the group now that Nicodemus belonged to. Are you going to find somebody in a group like that? Are you going to find somebody that has a heart for God? Well, he said, well, absolutely not. That's why people call him, well, he's a, gives them a denominational name, and you know about them, all of the people of that name, you know how they are. That's how people talk, see? Well, we found such a man. Nicodemus was in that group that we just heard about. He was in there. He was in them, but he wasn't of them.
So he was
the Pharisees. Right.
He,
Pharisees.
He served God with a clear conscience.
That's right.
Yeah.
So see, this was a general classification, but that didn't mean everybody in there was like this. And here's an example. Saul of Tarsus was another. Nicodemus probably heard those words about Jesus said, because he said them. He directed them right at the Pharisees, Matthew 23. So he probably heard those words, but he wasn't repulsed by them.
Yeah, that's right.
He wasn't repulsed by them. Now, you can tell for yourself how close you are to God by what it takes to offend you.
Yeah, that's right.
That'll tell them.
Yes, amen.
He wasn't offended. Others were exposed to the same words as Nicodemus, and they tried to kill Jesus. He comes to Jesus for a private caucus. He saw Jesus as someone to be pursued. The others saw him as someone to you got to get rid of. What a difference. Same group, but two completely different kind of people there. Here's Nicodemus, represents one. This should assist us not to classify people according to who they meet with. This is not that easy to do because, you see, some of us have been schooled to think in terms of he's a and she's a. We've been taught to think like this, see? Preaching's like this. Someone says, he's a Calvinist. Oh, boy. See? Oh. Why do they do that? See, they don't know this. They think that because a person's in a group that he agrees with the group. I can tell you, I was in a group and I wasn't in agreement with them. Yeah, Sister Melissa's one. She was with a Jehovah's Witness. Just in case you didn't know. But in her heart, she wasn't a Jehovah's Witness. She was one because she found them to be more serious than the evangelicals. Is that not right? Do you know there's some people that go to other churches because they can't stand dead ones? There's people like this. Nicodemus was a person like that.
Yeah, I was thinking about Nicodemus in this aspect. Maybe the things he heard from Jesus awakened some things in him, and he examined himself in this, and he saw.
You're exactly right. You're exactly right. That's what happened. Amen. Yes.
Yeah. You'll see that when Jesus came on the scene, he brought out what people were really like.
That's right.
If Jesus hadn't met Nicodemus, we might not know about Nicodemus. If Jesus hadn't come in as the light of the world, we wouldn't have known what was in those Pharisees.
Amen.
See, but the acid test is not how someone relates to a group of people.
Amen.
The acid test is how do they relate to Jesus.
Amen.
That's the,
amen.
And on the day of judgment, we're not going to be judged by group.
That's right.
We're going to be judged by the Lord Jesus is going to judge the world.
Amen. And really, when you get down to it, there's only two groups.
Yeah, that's right.
Right? Yeah. There's tares, wheat, sheep, goats, children of the wicked one, children of God. There's really only two. Two groups. And sometimes on earth, people that don't like where they're at, but they don't know any alternative. That's why Jesus has got to become prominent in preaching and discussion and teaching. Jesus has got, because he's the one that'll bring out what these things are.
Amen.
The Lord says, he first of all tells you about Babylon the Great, Satan's fabricated church. No hope for it. It can't be converted. It's going to be destroyed. He tells what it is. He says, come out of her. My people.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. God's got some people in there.
Amen.
They're uncomfortable in there. Mm-hmm. But for whatever reason, that's where they are. Come out. Mm-hmm. Get out of there.
Yeah.
Why? Because when I bring it down, it'll hurt you if you're not out.
Yes, amen.
That's why I left. Mm-hmm. Once you know what you're a part of can't ultimately win, which is a hard and painful lesson to learn, if it's true. But if you have come to that conclusion, this thing is off kilter, you got to get out. I might add it only if you can see that. Otherwise, you might jump out of the frying pan into the fire, as they say. Only John mentions Nicodemus. No other gospel writer mentions Nicodemus in this passage. And he also tells us that later on, Nicodemus spoke up in behalf of Christ. When the others were trying to plot how to get rid of him, he said to the Pharisees among that group, he said, does our law judge someone before they know what he says and does?
Yeah.
He said he could tell this isn't a righteous approach that you're taking here toward Jesus. And John also tells us Nicodemus joined with Joseph of Arimathea, who was a wealthy man, mm-hmm. in handling the body of Jesus. Mm-hmm. As Nicodemus joined Joseph of Arimathea, they were bold. They come and ask Pilate for the body. I mean, that took some. That took something, huh? Mm-hmm. Asked for the body of Jesus, and they brought a 100-pound weight of aloes. 100 pounds, that was a Roman pound, which would keep our pounds be like 75 pounds of spices in which to wrap Jesus. I mean, that's how precious Jesus was to them. They took the body of Jesus and wound it in linen clothes with the spices, as to the manner of the Jews is to bury. Now, it says of Nicodemus, he was a ruler. He was a ruler of the Jews. Other versions tell you he was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He was a leader of the Jews, a prominent leader. Amplified Bible says a ruler, a leader, an authority among the Jews. Now, for the most part, these people have been cultured by Moses and the prophets. And when they thought leader, ruler, they thought of someone that knew the scripture. In their culture,
That's right. This
is what qualified a person to be a leader. Mm-hmm. They knew the scriptures. Mm-hmm. Kings, for instance, never did anoint prophets. Uh-huh. Prophets anointed kings. This was a sense of values.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm saying that because this sense of values has flown the coop.
That's right.
This view doesn't exist to any measurable degree. Yeah. In our society, some of the scripturally dumbest people there are preachers and elders and teachers.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyone who's trafficked in the Christian community knows this. I know it sounds offensive, I know this, but if you've been around and listened and take part in discussions among these people, you should know this.
Yeah.
Very well. But what I'm pointing out is, in a group of people God cultures and God raises, He puts a value on a different kind of person.
Yeah. Amen.
Shepherds are people that feed the flock, not govern the flock.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, see, that's what a ruler was. He was a leader. This is one of theirs, one of the Jewish peculiarities. Moses, the high priest, and the prophets, they were premier.
Mm-hmm.
In Israel, they were premier, see? But they were known for their knowledge of God and their knowledge of the things of God. And that's what gave them the ascendancy.
Mm-hmm.
But in today's society, an old minister that knows the word of God, he's on an emeritus status. He's maybe he could visit the sick or something like that, but he's not considered of value, and all you have to do is traffic around and talk to some retired ministers.
Yeah.
This is why I moved here in 1992, because I personally knew 100 ministers and teachers from this area that had quit. So I was going to, my aim was to kind of encourage them, and they were beat down so much they didn't want to get back in the stirrups again. Why? No place for him. Well, I met broken-hearted Seth Wilsons, Carl Ketchersides, Don Earl Boatman. I met all these people. I knew all these people personally. When they were their most valuable, they were dismissed. What's the difference between that and what we're talking about? This is not the kind of organization God sanctions. It is not. You may find 1,000 good things about it, and whatever is good about it, I wouldn't deny or reject at all. But this is something that should be at the premier. Men who are experts in God's word should be calling the shots.
Yeah, that's right.
As far as the church is concerned. Business that the deacons can handle that. But they have to be full of the Holy Spirit and faith. Yes, same things he has happened to the church that happened to Jewry. Eventually, these premier leaders, like David, he was a great king because of his understanding of God and so forth, the prophets and so forth. Pretty soon they were replaced by false prophets and decadent kings. And when that happened, things went down. Things went down. Now, the same thing exactly has happened to the church. Church started out, continued steadfastly the apostles' doctrine, fellowship, breaking of bread and prayers. Before the first century was completed, other kinds of leaders arose. Paul said, said to the elders at Ephesus, some of your own flock are going to rise and take disciples unto themselves. He told them. When that happened, church went down, and that's what we got today. The reason it's in this state is its lead. This is where its leaders took it. And if any church has surfaced, it's because that's where the leaders took it. This is how God works. See, this is what you got to see. In Israel, when they begin going down, he'd raise up prophets, premier men. Sometimes then there'd be a little awakening that would happen, but it happened because of these men that knew God and the purpose of God, the scriptures of God. All of that is to accent that in the Jewish economy they corrupted it. I admit, but the men who knew the things of God, the Word of God, these were considered rulers. Godly men are considered the same today. Hebrews 13 says, obey them that have the rule.
That's
what he said. Romans 13, 7 and 17. Obey them that have the rule over you, who have spoken to you the word of God, whose faith follow. See, those are the leaders. Maybe it doesn't make sense to you when they say something. Maybe it doesn't make sense to you. But if they walk close to God, listen to them. So here comes Nicodemus from the Pharisees. He came to Jesus by night, or at night. New Living Translation says one dark evening. The ministry of Jesus was sandwiched between two nights. The first night when Nicodemus came to him, the last night when he prayed in Gethsemane. See, his whole ministry is in between two nights, and you might call that period day that was in between there. Came to Jesus by night. Now, there's been a lot of speculation about why he came at night. Some people say, well, he was scared of the Jews. Well, I don't think that. I don't think that's right. I think when he spoke up in the council, that told you he didn't have a fear of the Jews. I think he came at night because he wanted some quality time. Yes.
That's exactly what I was thinking. Yeah, so with all the crowds around, like, how do exactly you get one-on-one time with Jesus unless everyone's gone? Yeah.
He was in quest for the truth. And, you know, I don't think there's any example in Scripture of Jesus having an extended one-on-one conversation with somebody while he was going around ministering. You'd have to kind of search and see if that's true, but I'm pretty sure that's true. He was busy. Nicodemus wasn't looking for like a brief word or something like that, or not maybe even a miracle. Wasn't like Herod. Herod wanted to see Jesus. He hoped Jesus would work a miracle right in front of his eyes. He wanted to see a miracle. I still know people want to see a miracle. You know, those are the people that will never see one. So this incident reveals to us the fervency of Nicodemus' quest for the truth. In other words, when he heard Jesus and he saw Jesus, he said, there's something here that I want some more of what he has. Want some quality time with him. And he saw it at nighttime. That's what David did that. David, he'd give quality time with God at the nighttime. You read the Psalms in the night, songs in the night. You've instructed me in the night and night season. So that's the sort of spirit that he had. And he said to him, Rabbi. Other versions say teacher or master. Most all versions read Rabbi. Rabbi is what we call a transliteration. It's a conversion of Hebrew letters to English letters of the Hebrew word rabbi, which sometimes is translated teacher, but it doesn't really mean just teacher. The literal meaning of the word is my great one, my honorable sir, my great one, oh my master, oh my lord. It is not the word of a student to a teacher, but of a servant to a master. That's what the word rabbi means. So he was coming as a subject, not as someone who could learn, but as someone who could obey and follow. See, rabbi. This word is more than a title. And I might say that at some point, all of God's people have to learn to say this word rabbi. I don't mean like pronounce the word rabbi. Hear, my Lord, what will you have me to do? At some point, every person coming to Christ at some point has got to say this. What do you want me to do?
Amen.
What shall we do? What must I do? See, you got that? That's a rabbi response. We know thou art a teacher come from God. We. I gather there's some other kindred spirits. They've been talking about this. Because you notice this. You notice this, that when you're impressed with Jesus, you talk about it to somebody. You know, this is just, this is what we believers do. Mm-hmm. We find somebody to talk with about this. So we know that a teacher come from God. You've come from God as a teacher. Some people today still don't know Jesus as a teacher. Tragic. That's a tragic situation. But there are a lot of people that don't know he's a teacher. They maybe have the idea of Savior, solving difficulties, working a miraculous, but they don't know he's primarily a teacher. Because ignorance, as Ephesians 4:18 says, alienates you from the life of God. In the kingdom of God, what you don't know kills you. Severs you from God. You can't live in a state of ignorance before God. Pharisees one time, they said similar things to Jesus, but it was a trap. They tried to snare him in his words, and here's what they sent somebody to say to Jesus. We know you're a teacher sent from God and teaches the way of God in truth. Neither carest thou for any man, for thou regardest not the person of men. See, that was their complimentary introduction. That's the time they said, tell us whether it's lawful to pay Caesar, tribute to Caesar. Huh? That was the question. So this was a trick question, and this was a subtle introduction. Yes.
Actually, they made themselves false witnesses by saying that, because if they had known that, they would have just subjected themselves to his word instead of challenging him.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Mm.
Yes.
also, Jesus, he doesn't expect ignorance from the people he is teaching.
Yeah.
And when you notice when he was teaching his disciples, whenever he asked them their questions, he always expected of them to know the answer.
Yes, amen.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Well, Nicod, yes.
To live by the wise is the word of life. The state of ignorance is the words of death.
That's right. Words of life and words of death. Yeah. Words of ignorance or words of death. Yes, that's true.
Think of it as ignorance, like when you drop off a cliff.
Yeah,
words
thank
of
you.
Life is catch yourself off a cliff and then you say you're first. Mm-hmm.
Yes. So Nicodemus was properly motivated when he came to Jesus. He didn't come out of novelty or to trap him or to try and come in the back door to justify the fact that he was a Pharisee. This isn't why he came.
Yeah.
He says, we know thou art a teacher come from God, for no man could do these miracles. See, now the miracles Jesus did had never been done before.
Yeah,
Jesus never duplicated a miracle someone else wrought. You just have to search and see if this is not the case. They were absolutely unique miracles. There's 36 of Christ's miracles are recorded in Scripture. And then we're told that if all the works that he did were recorded, the world couldn't contain the books, and that was just talking about the ones after he rose from the dead.
Yeah.
So there had been an outbreak. You see, Elijah worked 7. Elisha worked 14 in their life.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Jesus worked more miracles in a day than Elijah and Elisha. The most prodigious miracle workers before him than they did their entire lives.
Yeah, uh-huh.
Together, didn't work as many miracles as Jesus did just in a regular day.
Yeah,
uh-huh. So this tremendous outbreak of the miraculous that happened. Sometimes there are multitudes that be healed. Mm-hmm. Multitudes that be fed.
Yeah.
Someone that people were afraid to pass by with the wild man was. He was healed. No one had ever heard of a blind man being healed. See, all this had broken out all at once. And it got the attention of Nicodemus. Yes.
This is slightly a different context, but you remember when Israel was in bondage in Egypt and God sent Moses with signs.
Yeah.
Said, put your rod on the ground, it'll turn into a snake. Well, the Egyptian magicians did that too, but the account goes on to say the couple of snakes thrown by the Egyptian magicians got eaten by the rod of Moses.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So even then, the duplication was inferior.
Yeah, it run out. They couldn't turn the sand and the dust into life.
The plagues, they multiplied or they duplicated them for a while.
Yeah.
But eventually they told Pharaoh, this is the finger of God.
Yeah, they ran out of power.
That's a translation. We can't do any more.
See, if you're living for God, keep on living. Your enemies will finally run out of power.
Amen. That's right.
This is the way it is. You got to outlast them.
Yeah.
Keep on serving the Lord, and pretty soon they'll quit bothering you. This is how it works.
Amen.
But anyway, the worst they can do is kill you.
Yeah.
Amen. After that, they have nothing they can do.
That's right.
So these works got the attention of Nicodemus. He'd seen that they were unique and drew his attention. See, God had done this. Judah mentioned Moses. God gave Moses some signs because they'd been in bondage for 400 years. 4 centuries. It'd be like you being sent out to somebody. And they had, since the 1600s, they'd been in bondage for how many? 10 generations. Been in bondage. Nothing had happened. No miracle. Nothing had happened at all. No word from God. Nothing. all of a sudden this explosion of miracles happened. Eh? I'll tell you, you'll know revival's around the corner when stuff like that happens. It's my understanding that this something of that magnitude is going to happen before this world ends. There's going to be a sudden explosion of the truth of God, which God's going to do. It'd be like waking up a valley of dry bones. Like that. So he came to see no other prophets had done such a work, and John the Baptist didn't do one miracle. He didn't do any miracles. Mm-hmm. So Nicodemus, he knew Jesus was a teacher. Oh, this man's got to have something to say that I need to hear. All these signs point to that. See?
Yes.
He didn't come to see a miracle. He come to hear a word. The Athenians, they would just come to hear it, some new thing, you know. Well, wouldn't that be like New Yorkers? I remember when I used to go to New York and testify to New Yorkers. They'd say, that's very interesting. Well, see you tomorrow. Yeah. He's kind of politely ignored you. But nobody did that to Jesus. Why not? Because it was so different. But some people hated it because it was different, because it disrupted what they were doing. I know, I come from a background that if a revival broke out in a Baptist church, we'd get mad. Oh yeah, I'm telling you the truth. It's foolish to say it now, you know, but that's the truth. We said, how could something like that happen down there? See? Nicodemus wasn't that way.
Down there when nothing is happening.
That's really what we meant. We got the truth. How can so much happen there and they don't even have the truth, and we got the truth and nothing's happening here? Well, someone should say, well, that should be like a clue.
Yeah.
Well, Jesus, how are you going to respond to that? Here's someone that said, no man can do these miracles you've done unless God's with him. Teacher, how are you going to answer that? He says, well, verily, verily, I say unto you, except the man's born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. Yeah. I didn't know he was going to say something like that. Nicodemus didn't ask Jesus a question. He just made a statement, but Jesus answers his statement. He replied to the statement. He'll comment on the observation made by this Pharisee. It's something about Jesus that is often overlooked. He evaluates what you think and say.
Yeah,
amen. He'll answer what you thought.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing their thoughts, he said, see, he'll answer what you think.
Yeah.
He'll answer a statement you make.
Mm-hmm.
Well, as we know, blah, 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 Jesus will answer that.
Yeah.
That's just the way he is. You read things like, he said, to his disciples, what is it that you disputed among yourselves, by the way? We were walking along, you folk were behind there arguing. What were you arguing about?
Yeah.
Oh, they didn't want him. They didn't want him to know.
Yeah.
That they are arguing about who's going to be greatest. They didn't want Jesus to know what they were arguing about. And some things people argue about today that I know they don't want Jesus to know they was arguing about something that dumb. But he knows. And if you have you quiet your heart down,
mm-hmm.
if you quiet your heart down, Jesus will say this to you. What was that you had trouble with?
Yeah.
What was that? You were all worried. What was that you was worried about?
Yeah.
Oh, he'll talk to you about it.
Amen.
Another time he said, Jesus, knowing their thoughts, said, wherefore think ye evil in your hearts? Another time he said to the Pharisees, he perceived their thoughts. He said, what reason ye in your hearts? Well, Solomon wrote, go not forth hastily to strive. We get out there arguing about something. Don't be hasty to strive, lest thou know not what to do in the hand thereof, when thy neighbor had put thee to the shame. Sometime maybe you struck up an argument with somebody and he buried you.
Yeah.
Just made a fool of you in front of everybody.
Uh-huh.
Huh? That's what Solomon's talking about. Mm-hmm. Be careful. David once confessed, "For there is not a word in my tongue, but, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether." Well, that's a good confession. He goes, this is the way it is.
Amen.
God is aware of everything you said,
yes,
everything you wrote, everything you thought. He's aware of it.
Yeah.
And someday you'll confront it like the rest of us do. He says, verily, verily, verily. The New King James says, most assuredly. See, these are hard words to put in another language. New American Standard says, truly, truly. NIV says, I tell you the truth. New Revised Standard, very truly. I assure you, and so forth. The word translated from which verily is translated is amen. That's a Hebrew word. Amen. It means the statement that follows is the introduction, the body, and the conclusion. It can't be changed. It can't be altered. This is the most concise way to say it, but this is something that cannot be violated. There's no way. There's no way that what I'm going to say can be countermanded or negated or cast down or no way. It's a total, absolutely total statement. Amen. Nothing can be added to it. Nothing can be taken from it. He says, except a man be born again. Oh, boy, that's a new thought. There's a new thought there. Nobody talked about that. John the Baptist didn't talk about being born again.
Mm-hmm.
Huh? Except a man be born. So this is the first time.
Mm-hmm.
He doesn't say, now here's what the new birth is. He says, except a man is born again. That's the first time Nicodemus has heard directly heard about this. Now the new birth is prefigured by several statements made by the prophets. I'll give you some of them here. Thy God will circumcise thine heart. See, that's just another view of being born again. I'll give you a new heart and a new spirit. David prayed, create in me a new heart. Thy people shall be willing in the day of thy power. See, this is all various views of being born again. I will turn my hand upon thee and purely purge away thy dross and take away all thy tin. How much tin do you have? Tin, you know, it's an alloy. Tin's not a metal, it's a conglomeration, you know. How much tin do you have? Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. See, that's new birth. That's what that is. I will give them an heart to know me, that I am the Lord. I will give them one heart and one way, that they may fear me forever for the good of them and of their children after them. It's a new birth. I will also save you from all your uncleannesses.
Mm-hmm.
Uncleannesses.
Yeah. Right.
That's new birth. See that? But that what these were just people didn't think of it as a new birth, but that's what it was.
Mm-hmm.
The apostles would call this a new creation,
mm-hmm,
or a new creature. King James calls it. It means that man's basic or inner constitution is changed. Who he is, how he thinks, what he wants, what he understands is changed. Yeah, Brother Jason.
I think the interesting thing about this statement is the kind of man Jesus made it to. The implication here is that Nicodemus needed to be born again.
Oh, yes.
And the interesting thing about that is that most people would say that a man like Nicodemus wouldn't need that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
They've got, you know, the popular understanding of a born again person or someone who needs to be born again is like a drug addict.
Yeah.
Well, that person really needs to be born
again. He needs it, yeah.
But see, here's a man who's moral,
yeah,
mm-hmm,
who's religious,
yeah,
who's educated, who's a leader, but he needs to be born again too.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See what Jesus said. Nicodemus says, we know.
Mm-hmm.
We know. thou art a teacher sent from God. Jesus is saying, no, you don't know.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, amen.
Because if you're not born again, you don't know.
That's right.
You can't see, perceive, discern. You really don't know if I'm from God or not. This is your reason. You figure you've thought it all out. But you don't really, a person has to be born again to really know who Jesus is.
Amen. That's right.
That's quite a statement to make to him. Said the man's born again, he can't see. You can't tell where God's working. Unless you're born again. You can't tell where his kingdom's in operation. Unless you're born again. That's what he's saying. Except you're born again, you can't see, perceive, discern, comprehend. You don't know.
Yeah, that's right.
But if you are born again, then you are able to see and comprehend and discern. You cannot see the kingdom of God. So no person that's not born again can detect, perceive, or discern the true working of God, his kingdom. Everybody say, well, God's really at work over there, and he may not be over there at all.
Right.
Or they may say, God's not over there, that may be where he's working. They can't tell. They're born again. Why? Why? Because man's constitution has to be changed before he can see these non-natural things that God is doing.
Mm-hmm.
See, God's kingdom isn't of this world. My kingdom's not of this world. That's what Jesus said. My kingdom's not of this world. So if all you got is this world, well, yes, Brother Jason.
Here's another perspective of you must be born again. Jesus is saying to Nicodemus, you've got to start over.
That's good.
Now, again, this is not something you would think of for a religious man who's got a religious pedigree and everything.
That's right.
Jesus is saying, actually, you don't really understand anything, Nicodemus.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You've got to go back to spiritual kindergarten.
That's right.
And start over again, which, of course, that takes a lot of humility.
Yeah, amen. And Nicodemus knew that's what he was saying, because the lady, you know, he'll say, can I enter my second time into my mother? He knew that's what he was saying, yeah.
I'm thankful that the Word of God came through men and women who needed the same, they get the same grace that we get.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So we can, in different ways, I guess, but in the same principle, we have the same experience that Nicodemus had, where we all have misassessed our condition, just like Nicodemus did.
Yes.
And we all had Jesus open something to us that we had to have help to receive, just like Nicodemus did. And that's like consistent throughout the scripture.
Amen.
At different times, you'll find yourself in the book of Ruth, and you'll find yourself in the book of Psalms.
Yep.
And how different it would have been if the record of scripture came through an angel.
Yeah. Amen.
Uh huh.
So just again.
Yeah. Back in the Old Covenant, when people weren't regenerate, the only way that they could experience God was through these types of shadows, through the temporal creation. And he's basically telling them, all of that points to me. All of what you know about me is a type and a shadow that's pointing
to me. That's right. It's not the substance, yeah. Not the substance. All of the observations, see, are deductions of men, the conclusions and the reasonings of men, and the determinations of men concerning God that are natural are just theory and supposition and hypothesis. They're not real. There's a lot of people, and it grieves my heart that this is the case, whether maybe once I was among the number, that are talking about God, that don't know about God. They don't know him. They don't know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
They're presenting a thread of human logic. And Jesus is saying, no. He didn't say, no man can know these things. See? He opened a door now.
That's
he opened a door. There is a way to know. if you're born again, then you can know and you can see and you can profit from the see. So he left the door wide open. He didn't slam. Remember, he told the Pharisees, they shut the door.
Yeah.
Remember?
Uh-huh.
He told them, you shut the door.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus opened the door.
Amen.
You got to be made new. You got to be recreated.
Yes, amen.
And your first creation, you didn't have anything directly to do with that.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not going to have anything directly to do with the new one either.
Yes, amen. Remember when Paul met Christ, he said in Philippians, he said, whatever was to my profit, I count as loss.
That's right.
And
that's right.
Everything that I used to think that was to my advantage,
uh-huh.
and this is Paul as a Pharisee,
uh-huh.
everything that I used to think was to my advantage,
yeah. mm-hmm.
once I met Jesus, it was all dung.
Yes.
Yes, amen.
Yeah. And so you're born again,
uh-huh.
you come into another realm.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Where the things from the previous life count zero.
Yeah, that's right.
So that, otherwise, how could you abandon them? If they had a really genuine value, you'd want to hang on to him, but he saw I'm in a new domain in the heavenly places. What does all this stuff have to do with the heavenly places? It's not there. If you want these things, you got to come down to get them.
Yeah.
And pretty soon you say, I'm not willing to come down to get them.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I want the things that are up here, see? Evermore give us this bread.
Yeah.
Peter said that in the disciples when a lot of the others were going away. Remember, they were going away. He says, we, to whom are we going to go?
Yeah. Amen.
Now, this implies that Nicodemus was at that point incapable of a proper assessment of Jesus. He saw him as a teacher. But Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. But at this point, evidently, Nicodemus hadn't seen this. He's going to see it, but at this point, he didn't. He didn't see. He said, I see what you are. You're the Christ, the Son of the living God. That's not what he said. He said, you're a teacher.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
He has to decidedly lower than who Jesus really is.
Yeah.
Who's going forth from everlasting. Well, you can see you probably have had a kindred type experience. When you said something, you thought you knew what you were saying. You made some kind of an observation. You thought you were right on target, you know. And pretty soon you said, whoa, I was really off base there. What was it? That was Jesus saying you.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, you can't see these things in the flesh by nature.
Yeah.
You've got to come up. You got to come up. And to come up, you got to be raised from the dead.
That's right.
Like Jesus was before he went up. For Jesus went up, he was raised from the dead. Before you can go up,
uh-huh.
be seated in heavenly places, you too have to be raised from the dead.
Yes.
And that whole process is the being born again.
Amen.
That's one of those verilies.
Mm-hmm.
Said the man be born again, he can't see
mm-hmm.
the kingdom of God. And you sure can't enter it. Because you're going to say that later, too. You can't enter it if you can't see it. Good things, huh? Any of you have something else you'd like to say, Brother Jason?
Yeah, a couple of quick comments. It's amazing how Jesus is able to say to a person exactly what they need to hear.
Mm-hmm.
In chapter 4, he met that woman at the well, you know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And to her, he said, I'll give you living water.
Yep.
Well, that's exactly what she needed.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. See, there, and Nicodemus, you need to be born again. So that's exactly what Nicodemus.
Yeah,
he didn't say
right.
you, but that's the implication.
Amen.
See, that's exactly. There are people today like Nicodemus.
Yes.
They got knowledge, look very moral,
mm-hmm. yeah.
but they're not in.
Yeah.
And there's people like that woman at the well.
Yeah.
She was immoral.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. She was an outsider, a Samaritan.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus says, I can satisfy you.
Amen.
You're looking for something satisfying. It's amazing how Jesus can...
Amen.
Exactly what you need to hear.
Amen.
Yes, I was considering the fact that Jesus leads us in our thoughts and our understanding.
Mm-hmm.
He'll lead us in the way. saw that he was directing Nicodemus's thoughts in the way that he needed to think about and reason about these things. And I thought about how Nicodemus came to him, though. He had already been thinking. He had already been reasoning and musing upon the things that had been happening. And that's when Jesus was forward to lead him him to a more perfect understanding of those things. And so I was provoked in myself then to be alert in my thoughts, in my mind, reasoning and meditating on the things that the Lord's given and opened up. And then Jesus will be forward to lead to a more perfect understanding.
Amen. You will not be disappointed.
That's right.
Yes, Rachel?
Man can't go to God and still be in sin. We have to be cleansed from sin.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Amen.
Anyone else? All right, we'll have a word of prayer. Father, Heavenly Father, we thank you for this account. We thank you for Brother Nicodemus. How he was bold enough to stand up for Jesus, bold enough to come to Jesus, bold enough to help bury Jesus. We thank you for him. We pray that we'd have excellent responses to Jesus also. In his name we pray. Amen.